Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents Art Thinking: How to Carve Out Creative Space in a World of Schedules, Budgets, and Bosses by Amy Whitaker, narrated by Kim Niemi. I don't remember when I became an artist, but I remember when everyone else stopped being one. Vic Muniz, artist. Introduction. Saving lives versus making lives worth saving. I just want to encourage people not to wait for an ideal state of awareness. They must begin with the current means and with their mistakes. Joseph Boyce, artist. I grew up not completely understanding what a job was. My parents had an almost peculiar passion for what they did. My father was a neurologist so enamored with his work that he numbered his ATM pin code for a protein sequence in his favorite enzyme. He skipped lunch every day because it slowed him down too much. My mother, a medievalist, skipped lunch every day of graduate school to pore over illuminated manuscripts. Someone once asked my father how he and my mother got along so well being in such different fields. He said that he was in the business of saving lives, and she was in the business of making lives worth saving. The differences between their vocations were not as great as they first appeared. The truth was, they flipped roles all the time. He helped people with quality of life issues, like debilitating headaches or nerve damage that made it unpredictable and scary to walk. She taught people basic survival skills, like how to write incomplete sentences. That idea of saving lives versus making lives worth saving describes the general relationship between literature and science, in the case of my parents, and art and business, in the case of this book. At first, one looks like leisure and the other necessity, one like imagination and the other analysis, except that it is often hard to know which one is which. On January 17, 2008, a British Airways pilot named John Coward was bringing a Boeing 777 into land at London's Heathrow Airport. The plane had been in the air for more than 10 hours on its way back from China. In the last 2 minutes of the flight, within 2 miles of the end of a 5,000-mile journey, the engines failed. Working swiftly with the captain who adjusted the wing flaps, Coward pulled the plane just over the perimeter fence and landed it on its belly in the grass. No one was gravely injured. In describing the incident, the aviation expert Philip Butterworth Hayes said the pilots were dealing with a situation for which there is no training and the instruments are of no help whatsoever. In uncharted territory, they acted in a way that was both analytic and imaginative. The 150 metric ton aircraft is a masterpiece of technology, but to land it safely, they had to negotiate the physics of flight with the more human tools of ingenuity and split-second response. As the British Airline Pilots Association said, the crew, including the cabin crew who evacuated the plane, were ordinary people who did an extraordinary thing. The MFA is the new MBA. Like many children of specialist parents, my siblings and I became generalists. My brother became a COO/CFO type, warm and dry-witted with a vaguely militaristic streak. Our sister went into marketing and business development. I became a jack-of-all-trades kind of person. In some other life, I might have been a scientist or a policy wonk, but I became an artist instead, in the general DIY life assembly sense. Despite our parents' different fields, ours was a household of epic and unspoken Calvinist work ethic. I had always loved to draw, but found it hard to see the public service in making art. Even with the saving lives versus making lives worth saving moral complexity, if elected officials had to rank order giving money to road repair, cancer research, and art education, it wasn't hard to see which came in third. It was easy to see the immediate need to help the sick and repair what was broken. But in the long run, art is aligned with imagination, which is aligned with the cure for cancer itself. Creativity is also behind the economic successes that make the roads possible. And the roads are worthwhile for getting places besides the beige cubicled world. Making Lives Worth Saving has its own claim on necessity. Art and science, leisure and work, invention and execution are all parts of the same system. After college, I went to work in art museums because I thought they were public libraries for imagination. It turned out their inner workings were decidedly economic, and I went to business school in hopes of becoming a museum manager. The plot of my life splintered in 2001, the summer after business school. Within a month, our father died suddenly, the corporate job I had taken was canceled, and 9/11 happened. A year later, I made a life decision as much as a career one and enrolled in an MFA in painting program at the Slade School of Fine Art in London. In 2004, the year I finished art school, Daniel Pink declared in the Harvard Business Review that the MFA was the new MBA. James J. Cramer wrote that Wall Street analysts should get fine art degrees so that they could, like the great modernists, spot undervalued AT&T stock before everyone else. On the ground, the cultures were almost comically different. Business school was full of frameworks so general we could apply the same one to population control and toothpaste marketing. My Navy interview suit felt so generic I taped plastic airline wings to the lapel and wore it for Halloween. Art school, by contrast, overflowed with patternless and singular events. One day I crested the grand worn marble staircase of the Slade building. On the landing, someone had placed a banana on which they had written, "Please put me in your ass." The only person in art school who wore a suit was fellow painter Nick Brown, and only once when he had been out all night at a burlesque strip club and then come into the studio directly to paint, still wearing three-piece pinstriped tails. Having an MFA and MBA as of 2004 made me somewhat exotic, but what was surprising was to realize how intertwined creativity and commerce actually are for all of us. This book is a meditation and a manual, a manifesto and a love story for how art, creativity writ large, and business go together. It is about how to construct a life of originality and meaning within the real constraints of the market economy. It is about how to make space for vulnerability and the possibility of failure within the world of work, with its very real and structural pressures to get things done, to win praise and adulation, and to contribute to bottom-line growth. My perspective is not as a captain of industry, but as someone who has spent more than a decade working and playing in two very different worlds, art and business, and thinking about how they come together. Ultimately, business represents strength, art, and flexibility. To be an athlete, a whole person, you need both power and range of motion. The particular ways in which you decide to combine art and business, invention and execution, will stem from many different questions that we will come to address by the end of this book. The A word. To really talk about art and business together, the first thing we need is a more versatile Swiss Army knife definition of what art is. Art traditionally means objects like paintings or sculptures. The term more recently includes the highly conceptual or de-skilled works that people puzzle over in museums and galleries. That confusion about art is not new. In 1926, Constantin Brancusi's sculpture Bird in Space got stopped in customs and labeled as kitchen utensils and hospital supplies. In 1974, the German artist Joseph Beuys, who famously proclaimed that everyone is an artist, made an artwork that consisted of locking himself in a room with a live coyote, a wool blanket, a cane, and daily delivery of the Wall Street Journal. Our remit here is more universal and does not require you to lock yourself in a room with a news source and a predatory animal. The German philosopher Martin Heidegger attempted to define the category of art in a 1947 essay called The Origin of the Work of Art. In a testament to how difficult that is to do, Heidegger worked and reworked his argument from 1930 until 1960, republishing it periodically. I like to think that defining art is so hard, he only stopped working on it in 1976 when he died. To adapt a definition from Heidegger, A work of art is something new in the world that changes the world to allow itself to exist. You can simulate the experience of the original Heidegger essay by pausing and listening to that sentence a couple of times. Changing the world to allow something to exist. In this model of progress, you move forward not just by winning a game, but by creating the game itself. If you are making a work of art in any area of life, you are not going from a known point A to a known point B. You are inventing point B. You are creating something new, an object, a company, an idea, your life, that must make space for itself. In the act of creating that space, it changes the world in however big or small a way. By this definition, art is less an object and more a process of exploration. Many things outside the art world are art. Computers and 747s, counterinsurgency manuals and business models, afternoons and lives inventively spent. And conversely, many things inside the art world are high-end branded commodity products that trade on an art market, objects that are just recognizable enough and just scarce enough to function as alternative currencies. Getting the plane off the ground. Business prizes being able to put prices on things and to know their value ahead of time. Yet if you are inventing point B in any area of life, you can't know the outcome at the moment you have to invest money, time, and effort in the point A world. This is the central paradox of business. The core assumptions of economics, efficiency, productivity, and knowable value, work best when an organization is at cruising altitude, but they won't get the plane off the ground in the first place. That is to say, the history of business, the way we got here, follows from the kind of creative and open-ended work that the structure of business makes hard. Innovation has long been part of business theory. In 1942, Joseph Schumpeter coined the term creative destruction to describe the constant need for change and reinvention. Schumpeter argued that capitalism rests on change. Corporations that keep doing the same thing eventually go out of business. Invention is necessary for survival. Following patterns rather than inventing new ones will only get you so far. The people who devised those patterns didn't have a template when they started. Seeing how someone else started a $100 million company won't promise you the same outcome. The power fades in the copy. Change and reinvention are essential to longer-term success. The Economist magazine calculates growth of economies by tracking inputs, labor, and capital against outputs measured as gross domestic product. The amount of GDP not accounted for by capital and labor is attributed to innovation. In the United States and the United Kingdom, that unexplained amount accounts for more than half of GDP. In short, it is innovation more than the application of capital and labor that makes the world go round. Another way of saying that is that companies can grow by two means. They can grow by scaling up to the most efficient level of production, or they can grow artistically by the alchemy of invention. The riddle of the pin and the pencil. The friction between business structures and open-ended process comes from two allegories, one about a straight pin and one about a pencil. The first about efficiency, and the second about known value. In his 1776 book, The Wealth of Nations, Adam Smith, the godfather of economics, visits a pin factory and finds that if a single worker makes an entire pin by himself, he can make 20 in a day. But if 10 men divide pin making up into steps, they can make the equivalent of 4,800 pins per person per day, 240 times as many. The division of labor helps you make pins faster, but it doesn't help you make a better pin or figure out how to make a pin from scratch, whatever the pin is. The story of the pencil comes from Leonard Reed's 1958 essay, I, Pencil, a charming tour of how a pencil is made from the point of view of the pencil. The upshot is that no one person could ever make a pencil. Only the magic of the price system, to quote Milton Friedman's 1980 retelling, lets all the different actors, loggers, graphite miners, kiln operators, lacquer painters, and so on, combine efforts. The reason the pricing system works is the belief that price represents value. But if you are making something for the first time, you often can't know the value ahead of time when you're getting started. The Pin is a story about depth, about how to do one thing quickly if it is the only thing you do. The Pencil is a story of breadth, about how to coordinate with other actors to assemble your small parts into a whole. Together, they describe the efficiencies of execution and the possibilities of trade. They do not, however, describe the messiness of starting and the uncertainty of trying that are required to invent a point B. Traditionally defined, art itself has a long history of scrambling the idea of efficiency. Ever since the invention of photography, making a painting at all is an act of willful inefficiency. The information age also changes what it means to be efficient in the first place. The successful fashion brand Zara does not run its factories at full capacity. It reserves 50 to 85% of its own factories so that it can be responsive to trends in mid-season. The company can get feedback from its stores as to what is selling well and then use the extra capacity to make more of those pieces. Efficiency becomes lateral. Being able to coordinate complex systems becomes as valuable as producing things quickly. The stories of the Pencil and the Pin can lead to forms of magic that wring value out of scarce resources, or they can act like a steamroller that keeps you head down, making your part of the straight pin or the pencil. Art thinking bends the stories of the Pencil and the Pin so that you can protect and inhabit the before picture, the time before the pencil or the pin was designed, or the time when not even Watson and Crick knew what a double helix was or why it mattered. Championing that space is a human process, but one that also requires the tools of the market in surprising ways. The Art Thinking Framework. Art thinking is a framework and set of habits to protect space for inquiry. It will help you to dream big in ways that are completely lifted above, yet still tethered to reality. It is about how to structure and set aside space for open-ended, failure-is-possible exploration and to move forward by asking the big, messy, important questions, whether you know they are possible to answer or not. It is a form of optimism in the face of uncertainty. With these mindsets, you'll see clearly and make progress through the clunky process of making anything truly new. Art thinking then draws on tools of risk and return and investment management within the frameworks of operating a business. Those mindsets and tools come together to support the process of art and all of the vulnerability, risk of failure, actual failure, negotiation, and surprise involved in open-endedly and open-heartedly creating the life and the working life you want. The chapters of this book trace the steps along this path from the mindsets of art through the tools of business. 1. From a wide angle, zoom out and see everything from a wide-angle view. Economic theory models an object-based method of producing a product efficiently, but your life is really the entire ecosystem around the object. Your work and leisure are not always separate. As in the case of Thomas Fogarty, the inventor of the balloon catheter, a breakthrough idea can come from anywhere. You need to develop habits of what I will call studio time, ways of setting aside empty space in the landscape of your life. Paradoxically, in order to fully access these advantages, you may need to relax your hold on goal completion and efficiency enough to even feel like you're wasting time. 2. In the weeds. Change your focus from outcome to process and from comparing your work in progress to other people's completed projects. After it was completed, Harper Lee's book To Kill a Mockingbird came to look like a masterpiece that sold 40 million copies, won the Pulitzer Prize, and became a film with Gregory Peck. While Lee was writing it, she worked for many years as a reservations agent for the airlines and, in her words, wore through 3 pairs of blue jeans sitting at a desk. When you look at other people's creative projects, you see them from the outside, after the fact. When you look at your own, you see them from the inside, in the weeds. To counteract this bias, you need to change your relationship to judgment and to adopt tools for sitting with the vulnerability of not yet being at the end. 3. To the lighthouse. Trade outcome goals for questions that guide you forward. Given the realities of being in the weeds, the way to navigate is not toward a solution, but from a question. The question becomes a lighthouse that guides you forward toward your point B. That question can arise from a general sense of, is this possible, as it did for Roger Bannister running the first sub-4-minute mile, or it can stem from the purpose of your organization, from your own expertise, or from your general experiences as a person. In a film, the question that propels the plot forward is deeper than the storyline itself. In screenwriting parlance, it is called an MDQ, or major dramatic question. Your lighthouse question has this deeper nature. It drives the plot of your life forward by connecting your personal authenticity and your external circumstance. 4. To make a boat. Manage risk by taking a portfolio view and by owning the upside of what you create. Even having a guiding question, you still have to take on risk and to invest time and resources to explore anything. How do you make those decisions? Here, you need the tools of the market. You need to think in terms of a portfolio of projects around your lighthouse. In the short term, income from one area can support investment in another. Over a longer period of time, the collection of projects functions like a diversified portfolio, with gains in one area balancing out losses in another. Like many artists, you may need to self-fund in the early stages as an individual or a company in order to get something off the ground. To reap those gains, you will need to own some form of shares in what you make. Planning for gains is critical because in the case of creative work, risk usually gets framed in terms of failure. But failure is only one kind of risk. True risk management also means planning well for the possibility of success. To manage downside risk, you need to balance your most uncertain projects against other areas with steady income. To manage the upside risk, you need to restructure how you are paid to include an ownership stake. In fact, the ways most industries structure ownership are outmoded. Apart from musicians and writers who are paid royalties and entrepreneurs who retain equity, many people do not own a portion of what they create. Owning shares makes it easier to assign value that is not yet known. Technology makes it simpler to manage networks of fractional shares more easily than ever before. 5. To be in the fray. Assign roles and adapt tools of conversation to set culture and manage projects. For the mindsets of art thinking to thrive in an organizational setting, you need to create a conducive environment for creative work. The manager becomes more like an art school teacher or a guide. As you see in especially successful companies like Pixar, you need what I will call colleague friends, people who understand your expertise but also relate with the generosity of friendship. In tandem, you can designate specific roles that help bridge the idealism of creation and the realities of execution. Generalizing from film production, a producer can engage in the parallel creative process of bringing an idea into the market. And adapting project management tools used by computer programmers, you can designate roles, define milestones, and structure larger-scale working processes around open-ended lighthouse questions. 6. To build a house. Build artistic business models working within the design constraints of capitalism itself. Anything you produce, whether a house or a meal or a pair of glasses or a consulting report or a university education, whether for love or money, has a cost structure. Its production is made up of fixed and variable costs. Fixed costs are those like factory rent that don't change in the short term no matter how many pairs of glasses you produce. Variable costs are those like acetate frames or metal hinges that do. The combination of fixed and variable cost forms the internal skeleton of the business model. The money the business makes has to cover the cost structure or else the business will fail. The particular combinations of fixed and variable costs tell you the species of the business, including some fascinating patterns of business models that are unique to our time. Designing business models is artistic in a way that extends beyond the mechanical truth of cost structure. The builders of business models become the artists of enterprise. 7. To see the whole. Navigate the complexity of organizations and disciplines to tackle the big questions of the day. In so many complex projects, the artist is really a team more than a single person. How do you orchestrate conversations to create this kind of meta-generalist, a generalist built out of many people? Universities are laboratories for the kind of cross-disciplinary thinking that we need in order to engage with the largest questions about the environment or student debt, about the structure of working life or the design of the economy itself. The role of the individual is to own your own metaphor and to build skills to be able to ask questions, if not answer them, in any field. Everyone is an artist and a business person. What is true for everyone, for artists and for business people, is that there is no such thing as space outside the market, only the possibility of space within it. For all of us, the market economy is the fabric of our lives. It is almost impossible for anyone to avoid participating in it. People work, get a paycheck, run businesses, pay taxes, buy things, invest, raise money, and sometimes secretly hope to become rich. Doctors master insurance claim forms. Teachers manage book budgets. Artists hold day jobs. Students hold debt. Anti-market activists own iPhones. Even homesteaders who live in yurts in Montana buy duct tape. Every day, people try to make things, to start things, to navigate the formless beginnings of putting anything new into the world. The traditional ideas of the economy map a single vector system around making a profit. But the market is a broader and more flexible tool. It can still hold space for the early days of making things, putting them out there, and moving step by step into a future of your own design. Art, design, and creativity. Art thinking shares some similarities with design thinking, the framework for generalizing the process of designing a product into a creative problem-solving tool. The differences between art and design are somewhat academic, especially as fields of conceptual and speculative design flourish. But whereas a framework originating in product design starts with an external brief, what is the best way to do this? Art thinking emanates from the core of the individual and asks, is this even possible? Design thinking values empathy with users and rapid prototypes so that you can build a better airplane. Art thinking is there with the Wright brothers as they crash land and still believe that flight is possible. The definition of art is not about the size or magnitude of the point B world, a pebble skipped across a lake or a thunderous cannonball. The creativity guru Mihai Csikszentmihalyi, author of Flow and Creativity, makes a distinction between big C and little c creativity, the great works of Michelangelo compared to the very excellent Halloween costumes of regular people. That distinction does not apply here. The idea that big C and little c creativity are separate perpetuates the stereotype of artists as preordained geniuses. It grants people too much fortune-telling ability of the Monday morning quarterback variety. The way that Csikszentmihalyi describes little c creativity, as the kind all of us share just because we have a mind and we can think, describes the ground that all creative work comes from. If you are truly reinventing something, you may not know at the outset that it will be a big C kind of breakthrough. Even the Starbucks Corporation was a little C coffee shop when it began as a storefront near Pike Place Market in Seattle, Washington in 1971. Trying for big C creativity can crush the process of exploration. It can make you want to skip to the end. Creativity as a process only has traction with the present moment. The people in this book, writers, thinkers, parents, teachers, entrepreneurs, scientists, filmmakers, and even working artists, have found ways to design creative lives and whole organizations in the market economy. relative to the myth of artistic genius, their lives show patches of failure, talent in other fields, and years spent starting small. Their business models show the resourcefulness of starving artists and the belief that everyone has something to offer that is of value. Throughout this book, business is a term I use to mean organizational form in the economy, whether a household or a nonprofit, a small company or a multinational. Art is a term I use to mean the human capacity for exploration and originality, for thinking and making in ways that are uniquely your own. I use the term art willfully instead of relying solely on something more general like creativity because I want to borrow it back from the art world as an old-fashioned part of all of our humanity. And I use the term work broadly to describe anyone engaged in labor of any kind, paid or unpaid, publicly or privately. In my own life, I have written this book while working full-time, mostly as a professor teaching business to artists, designers, and arts administrators. I have worked in environments that are no more immune to politics and people complexities than anyone else's office. I have experienced love and loss, been unwell and then well, tried to install an air conditioner in a window, paid bills, binge-watched television on the internet, and otherwise been a person in the world. I hope all of that makes me a more honest guide. The questions in this book aren't ones you necessarily answer so much as revisit as a practice. The gift of art thinking is, paradoxically, in the idea that you cannot control the outcome of any endeavor and you might fail. That may sound like cold encouragement, but in so many situations, that permission to try and fail frees you to ask questions that really matter. It allows you, in the words of the designer Dror Benchetreit, to discover your own integrity. What I find most heartening is that at its best, creative work, the kind that merits the Latin phrase ars longa vita brevis, or art is long, life is short, comes from a core that is human and particular. The more you are yourself, the better chance you have to make your own contribution and to create your own life and work. The simple reality is that most of us need a paycheck, have a boss, and feel some weeks that Monday is like Tuesday, and Tuesday is like Wednesday, and Friday is only different because Saturday comes next. Even in that world of routine and duty, the tools of artistic process are available to everyone, and we can use them to build anything from inventive business models and management structures to well-spent afternoons and meaningful lives. What starts with an everyday feeling of, hey, I made this, whether that's dinner or a deal structure or a set of bookends, can expand into the largest of canvases. We create our lives. We build our workplaces. We design our society. We make our world. Art thinking is the process, and business is the medium. What would Leonardo do? Leonardo da Vinci is considered one of the greatest artists of all time, someone for whom the label genius is not hyperbole. He was an artist, but he was also a botanist, a defense engineer, an architect, and a scientist. He was a polymath. His brain was a university with all the departments. I have often wondered what Leonardo da Vinci would be doing if he were alive today. Would he have been standing outside an art school smoking a cigarette in three-quarter top sneakers, or standing on a stage in a black mock turtleneck pitching the first iPhone? The most satisfying answer I have heard lately came from Frank Vitale, a videographer and professor at the School of Visual Arts, who simply said that Leonardo would just be trying to figure something out. Being an artist is that process of exploring ideas, sometimes by means of producing objects, sometimes not. In that sense, being an artist is a part of all of us. Yet it is especially difficult to imagine Leonardo in contemporary life for two main reasons, which have to do with education and economics. It is harder to be a generalist now. Educational paths have become more specialized at the same time that information has proliferated. In his time, Leonardo could attempt to learn everything and wear his unique combination of botanist, defense, engineer hats. Leonardo also had patrons. Now you often have to invest in something yourself ahead of time to prove the concept. Countless organizations we now take for granted were self-invested in that way at the outset. What Leonardo's story points out is that we now need to design into the creative process systems for coordinating across many fields of knowledge and new ways of managing the financial risks of creative work ahead of time. Leonardo had advantages that few of us have, but that we can all try to replicate. Instead of knowing everything, we can imagine being able to ask anything and to own our curiosity toward everything. We can pose questions and have conversations in any field. We don't need to mimic creative genius. We need to find our own authenticity. Instead of slotting into pre-existing categories and labels, we can describe ourselves in our own terms and fully own our particular cross-sections of knowledge. We can be custom generalists and design our own metaphors. Instead of going hat in hand to the patron families of Italy or the King of France as Leonardo did, we can design more alternate funding arrangements like licenses, royalties, and equity stakes to better support exploratory work before its full value is known. We do not have to project the veneer of genius onto other people. Rather, we need to be honest and transparent about where we are. When you admire a finished project, a film, a song, or even a PowerPoint presentation, it is easy to feel distanced from the messiness of how it came to be. The finished work airbrushes out the realities of the perseverance and accident that brought it into being. That distancing does a disservice. It makes it so much harder to start. No doubt the world contains a few modern Leonardos who stand on that perch of genius with ease and elegance. But just as often, the world moves forward propelled by the inelegant, the sincere, the awkward, the slow, the quiet, the local, the unexpected, the inefficient, and the downright surprising. As a body politic, that motley collective effort does more to push society forward and to create meaning for individual people and value for organizations than any one miraculous Leonardo ever could. Finding space for that process allows amazing projects or whole enterprises to appear in the world the way most of us do, slightly gangly or shy, or adolescently a work in progress. The British writer G.K. Chesterton once observed, "We are perishing for want of wonder, not for want of wonders." Leonard Reed quotes Chesterton early on in his story of the market, iPencil. The world is full of wonders within the market and far outside. That sense of possibility does not yield to focusing just on work, but on the vast ecosystem of your whole life, and then defining the questions that will propel you forward. Chapter 1. From a Wide Angle. A human being should be able to change a diaper, plan an invasion, butcher a hog, con a ship, design a building, write a sonnet, balance accounts, build a wall, set a bone, comfort the dying, take orders, give orders, cooperate, act alone, solve equations, analyze a new problem, pitch manure, program a computer, cook a tasty meal, fight efficiently, die gallantly. Specialization is for insects. Robert A. Heinlein, Time Enough for Love, 1973. When you meet Thomas Fogarty, the cardiovascular surgeon who invented a medical device called the balloon catheter, he has a wry twinkle and the affability of someone who has, since 1978, owned a winery in Northern California. He is not one of those wiry surgeons who appear to run 10 miles each morning, alienatingly healthy and otherworldly in equal measure. He speaks in an Ohioan accent with wide-open A's and a cadence as simple and percussive as a one-drum musician in the New York City subway. It makes much of what he says sound like a punchline. This is fair. Dr. Fogarty is a pithy man. He possesses a childlike ability to see things as they are while also trying to make them better, as observant of the broad design challenges of modern medicine as of any single device. He speaks like a doctor, that subset of the population who can say, he died of cancer of the rectum, the way someone else might say, I'm going to the store to buy oranges. He's not unfeeling. It's his own father who died that way when Fogarty was in grade school. He had already seen his father taken away to an asylum, straitjacketed, when Fogarty was about 5. Dr. Fogarty is part of that elite and dubious club of people who did something big in their youth. Not the captain of the football team who threw the game-winning Hail Mary pass, but a badly behaved, resourceful kid who invented a medical device that opened up the world of non-invasive cardiovascular surgery and that still saves 300,000 lives each year. Fogarty's story springs from what I call a whole-life approach. His insight came not from separating his work life and his leisure time, but from a wide-angle view toward the combination of both. Growing up in the 1940s and 50s, Fogarty was never in terrible trouble, but he was a self-proclaimed juvenile delinquent who had to be either busy or supervised. When the teacher wasn't looking, he would jump out of the window to go fly fishing. Not knowing where he had gone, his teacher would call his mother at her job, where she supported three kids by working at a dry cleaner's, what Fogarty called a sweatshop in every sense of the word. So, in the eighth grade, Fogarty got a job at the Good Samaritan Hospital in Cincinnati, Ohio. The sole reason he went to work there was that hospitals were exempt from child labor laws. He was only 13. Fogarty started as a dishwasher in Central Supply, cleaning out stomach pumps for 18 cents an hour. The cleanup job was so grim he invented a new dishwashing agent made from green soap, ether, and baking soda to cut the time in half. Much of the life of the hospital passed through Central Supply, providing Fogarty's Venn diagram brain a chance to build up a mental encyclopedia of usable forms, a certain shape of scissors used in gastric procedures that could, if scaled down in size and changed slightly in angles, be used for eye surgery. Fogarty was observant, and the doctors let him sit in on a lot of things. By the time he was 15, he had seen two autopsies. There were a lot of things you just learn without the intent of learning. You just make an observation and say, "Holy cow." Already, Fogarty had a synthesizing mind and an impatience with a lack of action. He wanted to do things. Around the age of 15, Fogarty became a scrub technician, an assistant inside the operating room for a surgeon named Jack Cranley. Dr. Cranley had 10 kids. Fogarty essentially became the 11th. One of the main procedures in Dr. Cranley's surgical practice was the removal of blood clots. To retrieve a clot, a surgeon would have to make an incision the length of the blocked artery and open it up in its entirety. Sometimes patients died or had to have limbs amputated. Those who healed often bore long scars on their chests or legs. They'd do an operation, which would take about 8 hours, and then 1 or 2 days later, the patient would be back in the operating room having his legs cut off. When you see that repetitively, you say, there has to be something better than this. Fogarty had always been a tinkerer and entrepreneur. As a child, he built soapbox cars and model airplanes so good he sold them to neighbors. He bought the model airplane kits for 18 cents and sold the finished planes to other kids for $7 or $8. He was his mother's personal handyman, fixing anything she asked him to. Fogarty even worked part-time in a motorcycle repair shop that mainly serviced scooters. The manual clutch on a scooter had a problem when you dropped into a low gear. If you were going up a hill, you'd lurch forward and suddenly find a certain part of your anatomy on the street, with the scooter about 10 yards ahead of you. My idea was to smooth that transition. Fogarty and his friend invented the predecessor to the centrifugal clutch that is still in widespread use today. They wouldn't profit financially from the invention because the garage owner had a claim on their intellectual property through shop rights, something Fogarty would remember. Later, when his mentor, Dr. Cranley, advised him to get an intellectual property attorney, he listened. Blood clots were a problem far worse than landing on the seat of your pants off the back of a scooter. Dr. Cranley challenged Fogarty to find a better solution, and so the scrub technician started experimenting. He was working with a urethral catheter, a piece of vinyl tubing like a tiny garden hose, and the single pinky finger of number 5 latex glove. He wanted to build a device that could, in a compressed state, be threaded through an artery past a blood clot and then expanded to rake a clot back, pulling it out through a single, much smaller incision. "I think I tried 2 or 3 other things that didn't work, but the minute that idea came to me, it was pretty clear it was going to work." By 1959, Fogarty was in his 4th year of medical school, tinkering with the balloon catheter in his attic. He had just decided to become a heart surgeon. As he explained it, cardiologists certainly do a lot now, but all they did then was read EKGs and pronounce people dead. He imagined what the balloon catheter would look like, but his key challenge was that no glue of the late 1950s and early 1960s would make latex and vinyl adhere. Fogarty's breakthrough was to tie the device together with the fly fishing knots he learned while cutting school. I'd always tied flies and made lures, so it was just a natural thing. And so it turned out that a device that is still in use today, saving more than 20 million lives or limbs since it was introduced, came into being not from specialized expertise or a large pharmaceutical lab, but from a Huck Finn propensity for jumping out of windows to go fishing during school and an imaginative leap from the domain of fly lures to the design challenge of adhesion. The idea of a whole life approach, that your work and your leisure are not always separate, that necessity and luxury sometimes cross over, that the whole accounts for the success of the part, opens up broad questions about pathways to progress and habits of creative work. Thinking about your life as a whole ecosystem is the first step. The object and the environment. In his 2005 commencement address at Kenyon College, the writer David Foster Wallace told the story of the fish. There are these two young fish swimming along, and they happen to meet an older fish swimming the other way, who nods at them and says, "Morning, boys, how's the water?" And the two young fish swim on for a bit, and then eventually one of them looks over at the other and goes, "What the hell is water?" Economics assumes a world of profitable products. It is a world of fish, not water. Whole life thinking models the world as the entire system, taking into account all of life underwater. The fish can be anything, a report, a number, a person, a product, seen in isolation as if it is floating on the green screen of your life. This kind of object-based thinking can lead to an artificial separation of different spheres. It can lead you to judge what is important or unimportant prematurely and to miss out on the times a solution to a problem comes holistically from another area of life. In his 2003 book, The Geography of Thought, the social psychologist Richard Nisbet recalls the origins of his graduate student Takahiko Masuda's research. Masuda, a 6'2" football player, arrived at the University of Michigan, there straight from his native Japan, and wildly excited to take in his first Big Ten game. In the colossal and electrifying stadium in Ann Arbor, Masuda was shocked by what he perceived as the rude behavior of the people around them. In Japan, he had been taught to watch his back, to be mindful of how his location in space affected other people. There in Michigan, fellow fans were standing up right in front of him with no awareness that they were keeping him from seeing the game. Masuda designed an experiment to see if he could isolate this cultural difference. Masuda hypothesized that Eastern and Western audiences simply perceived the world differently. The Eastern view held up a kind of wide-angle lens of looking out for others and noticing the context. The Western view focused...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.